the ceiling menace of Delhi as far as the cadres are concerned. Also, simultaneously, the faulty implementation, wrong implementation of the GST, and the adverse impact of the demonetization. So these are the real issues which the traders are confronted with. Ceiling on top of this has created an atmosphere wherein the trading community is in a state of shock or always uncertainty that they may have to close down their establishments. The government employees are unhappy with the 7th pay commission report, with the recommendations of the 7th pay commission report. During our time, we had given them the 6th pay commission report, which was by far the best pay commission report ever. So the government employees are still remembering the Congress party's 6th pay commission, and they want us to come back and remove the anomalies of the 7th pay commission. And the worst part of the 7th pay commission report is that it has suggested there will be no further pay commission reports for the government employees. So the pay commission report is an instrument by way of which the government employees, the serving government employees, they get a raise, as well as the pension of the government employees also gets an increase through the pay commission report. So it is not only the serving government employees, but the retired government employees also who are going to face a brunt because of this recommendation, which has been accepted by the government. As far as the poor people are concerned, the issues which we are raising with them is in the slums, that no in situ rehabilitation of slums have been carried out by any other government. And the street vendors also, in the last 5 years, despite a street vendors right livelihood act, which I got it drafted and I had got it passed through the cabinet, that street vendors livelihood protection of livelihood act is not been properly implemented in Delhi.
Sir, how do you propose to resolve, say, like the ceiling issue?
The ceiling issue, I was the minister in 2006 when the same thing came up, the ceiling issue. So we amended the master plan more than 170 places. So more than 170 amendments to the master plan was made. We brought in an act in the parliament within 1 week's time, Delhi Law Special Provision Bill. We introduced it in Lok Sabha on 12th May 2006 and on 19th May it was passed by both the houses of parliament and also stamped by the President of India. So similarly, I think that the government of the day should strive to find a balance between the court's orders, environment concerns, and also concerns of the traders, small traders, livelihoods of the small traders. And it can be easily done through the master plan. Already there are provisions in the master plan which have not been implemented. And if there needs to be any amendment in the master plan, they should be doing that. It is just like they blame Jawaharlal Nehru for the present set of unemployment. Nothing more. But that is what I am saying. I brought 170 amendments to the present master plan. Through the master plan, I notified 3,000 roads for commercial and mixed land use. 3,000 roads have been notified as commercial and mixed land use. 22 industrial areas were notified through the master plan. Why could they not add even a single road to the 3,000 roads? Why couldn't they amend even one amendment in the master plan after 170 amendments? So when they themselves have failed to do what I could do at that time, why blame me? Kejriwal is taking up as an excuse for his non-performance, Has he been able to explain to the people the financial ramifications of statehood? And secondly, more importantly, let him tell, will Delhi still remain as a national capital if Delhi becomes a state? No. If Delhi becomes a state, it won't remain as a national capital. And if you don't remain as a national capital, as far as law and order is concerned, as far as administration is concerned, you will be as bad as any other state. Is law and order situation better in Ghaziabad? Is law and order situation better in parts of UP or Bihar or even Haryana? So Delhi being national capital is much better off than any other state. because it gets priority funding from the government in various schemes. The spending on Delhi police annually is to the tune of 8,000 crore per year. So 8,000 crore rupees per year is entirely spent by the central government. So Delhi taxpayers have to pay zero amount for the security given by Delhi police. Similarly, as far as services are concerned, 3,600 crore rupees is the pension amount given to all the retired government servants, which is paid entirely by the central government. So there are so many things on higher education. All the three central universities, the Delhi University, JNU, Jamia, Delhi has three central universities. The entire amount is borne by the central government. The super speciality hospital, AIIMS, Ramano Lohia Hospital, Safdarjung Hospital, the entire amount is borne by the central government. So Delhi being the national capital, center government I think would be spending more than 23,000-24,000 crore rupees on Delhi. So why should the Delhi taxpayers be burdened with these 23,000-25,000 crore rupees per year just because Kejriwal and Manish Sisodia want more power? I can just repeat that AAP and Congress alliance I wanted because it would have been easier for us to win all the seats. Right. Now it won't be as easy as it would have been had there been an alliance, but we will still win all seven seats. AAP also cuts into the BJP votes. What do you think that AAP only cuts into Congress? Why do you think this? Had they been cutting only into Congress's votes, then in 2015 they wouldn't have won 67 out of 70 seats. Congress never won 67 out of 70 seats, and a party has come and cut into Congress votes, and they have got 67 of the 70 seats. How is it possible they had they not cut into BJP's votes? So my simple logic is this is a false narrative created by the BJP that they are cutting into only Congress's votes. My simple question to this is that they got 67 out of 70 seats. Congress could never cross 53. So how can they get 67 out of 70 seats without cutting into BJP's votes? So they would have cut into BJP's vote to get 67 out of 70 seats. So it is not only Congress's votes that they had cut into, they have cut into a sizable number of BJP votes also. Congress votes have come back to the Congress party, and we very strongly feel now when we are moving in the ground, people feel that these are national elections. And since these are national elections, national party versus a national party, a national alliance versus national alliance is the answer. And Congress being a big national party is the only one to take on the might of BJP. So that is what people think, and that is why people will vote for the Congress in these elections. I don't think, because all our seven MPs, they are experienced old war horse. So Sheila Dixit, it is not her first election, and she is not new to that constituency. She contested way back in 1998 in that area. Arvinder Singh Lovely represented that area five times in the assembly where he is contesting parliament. So this is my fourth election from New Delhi. For AAP candidates or for BJP candidates, they are all new. For them, such things are important. But as far as Congress is concerned, we've got the most experienced candidates, and they know each and every area. And we are all otherwise also, even not as a candidate, we are all very active in the field and meeting people, and our programs are there in the area.